jihad. Very little mercy could be shown to the enemy until it is totally subdued, converted, or exterminated. To prove my point, just watch your TV screens every single day from all over the globe on how so-called peaceful Islam is butchering different sects of Islam, as well as slaughtering Christians, Buddhists, Hindus, Jews, and pagans, while shouting the jihadi terror verse of Allahu Akbar, called at-takbir, meaning the glorification of their God, Allah. This ideological weapon has been used throughout Islamic history, both against infidels as well as against other unbelieving sects of Islam. In all the Quranic verses, as well in the Ahadith, jihad is invariably associated with physical warfare and fighting, and not as a spiritual striving for a higher morality and or discovery of self. In the tradition of Muhammadan Islam, the world is divided into two major parts. One, Dar al-Salam, the territory of peace. They comprise territories completely under the control of Muhammadan Muslims. Al-Mu'mineen, the believers, which is made up of two components. A, Dar al-Islam, the territories with a majority of Muslim peoples. B, Dar al-Sulh, territories with a non-Muslim Muhammadan majority occupied and under the so-called protection of the Muslims. The other part of the world is called Dar al-Harb, the territory of war, which comprises all territories in the world that are not under the control of Muhammadan Muslims and considered to be in the hands of the alleged kuffar, unbelievers, and consequently are fair game for attack, despoliation, rape, and subjugation to Islam. In reality, there is no such thing as secular war in Muhammadan Islam, because from the very beginning of the Muhammadan Islamic polity, war and aggression were the means by which Muhammad and his followers built up their demonic empire. Jihad became a perpetual holy duty of warring against all infidels. That is a continuous war of aggression against all those who do not believe as they do in Allah and His Messenger Muhammad. These wars were not in defense of Islam, but to gain territory, economic wealth, slavery, booty, rape, and plunder. Converting other peoples to Islam was last on the agenda of Muhammad's followers, but became a very important byproduct of these wars of aggression. It is a cruel irony, if not actually divine justice, that among the largest victims of jihadi terror were and continue to be other Muslims. Each side of the conflict between two or more of the warring Muslim factions or sects accused their opponents of kufr and or unbelief, turning them into the enemies of Allah and then subject to divinely sanctioned destruction. In this manner, and according to the Quran, their holy book, since all are Muslims killing other Muslims, none will ever be received in paradise, but will assuredly end up in Allah's hell. For the listeners who doubt all the above, the following very few sample verses and hadiths should easily and conclusively sober them up. Al-Tawbah 9.5. But when the forbidden months are past, then fight and slay, faqtulu, the infidels, wherever you find them, and seize them, beleaguer them, and lie in wait for them in every stratagem of war. Al-Tawbah 9.29. So repeat, qatilu, fight, those who believe not in Allah, nor the last day, nor hold that forbidden which has been forbidden by Allah and His Apostle Muhammad, nor acknowledge the religion of truth, Islam, even they are of the people of the book, Christians and Jews, until they pay the jizya with willing submission and feel themselves humiliated. Sahih al-Bukhari hadith 4.50. narrated by Anas bin Malik. The Prophet said, a single endeavor of fighting in Allah's cause, qital fi sabilillah, which is jihad, is better than the whole world and whatever is in it. Sahih Muslim Hadith 4631 and 4626 by Abu Huraira. I heard Muhammad say, I love that I should be killed in Allah's cause, jihad. Then I should be brought back to life to be killed again. Sahih al-Bukhari Hadith 4.73, narrated by Abdullah bin Abi Awfa. Allah's Apostle said, know that paradise is under the shades of swords. There are hundreds more of similar verses in the Quran and Hadith for those who have the appetite for blood. I rest our case once more. Let us together explore the asinine mantra of Islamophobia that half-wit English or Greek language illiterate Muslims hurl upon anyone pointing out, like myself, the facts about Islam's satanic characteristics. Islamophobia is a neologism used to refer to an irrational fear or prejudice towards Muslims and the religion of Islam. The term has achieved a degree of linguistic and political acceptance which is utterly at odds with facts and reality. Let us firstly deal with the facts. One, Muhammadan Muslims are the only group on the face of planet Earth who show their anger, their destructiveness, their hate-mongering, and their war-mongering on television, in print, in their educational system, and in their speech against all other belief systems, be they Christian, Buddhist, Jewish, Hindu, or animist. Two, they are the only group who show their manifestations of hate and fury while holding their holy book, the Quran, in one hand, and guns, grenades, grenade launchers, swords, and daggers with the other. Three, they are the only group who, while demonstrating their hatred and antagonism, shout and call upon the name of their God with their terror verse, Allahu Akbar. Four, they are the only group who, in the name of Allah, slaughter unarmed and innocent civilians by the sword, suicide bombings, beheadings, blowing up planes, buses, trains, etc. Five, 100% of all acts of terror and aggression in the world against infidels today, Muhammadan Muslims have the pride of being the number one in at least 55 countries on four continents. Six, Muhammadan Muslim law called Sharia discriminates unreservedly against the following. A, all females, even if they are followers of Muhammad. B, all unbelievers, such as Christians, Buddhists, Hindus, and Jews. C, all homosexuals. D, all sects of Muhammadan Muslims who do not follow their methodology. Item 7, Muhammadan Muslims burn and destroy the holy places of other religious groups, such as churches, Buddhist temples, Hindu shrines, and synagogues without remorse. 8. Muhammadan Muslims show nothing but utter contempt for the beliefs, property, and lives of all those who do not believe as they do. 9. Muhammadan Muslims massacre, mutilate, rape, and destroy the lives and holy places of other Muhammadan Muslims who do not follow the same path. 10. Muhammadan Muslims in the Western democracies, while hiding behind freedoms of speech and belief, declare in public, in the media, and in their sermons, in every mosque, every Friday, that they intend to turn the Christian democracies into replicas of their depraved belief systems under Sharia. 11. Most Muhammadan and sickening acts and behaviors conducted daily in their name and in the name of Islam. 12. One can understand and sympathize with those Muslims who live under Islamic governments and live in fear of being in the opposition. But those who live in democracies have no excuse whatsoever in showing their disapproval, disgust and anger at those who are allegedly bringing Muhammadan Islam in disrepute. 13. It is one of the great ironies of history that it was Muhammad himself who said, silence means consent. Hence, the silence of the followers of Muhammad in the West does mean that they consent to what others are continuing committing in their name and in the name of Muhammad and Islam. In fact and in reality, they have no choice since those that the media erroneously call Islamic radicals, extremists or militants are actually the truest believers in the faith of Muhammad and Islam. Since they are only following what the Quran itself commands them to do in hundreds upon hundreds of verses. To force into conversion, to hate, to war, to subjugate, to slaughter, to plunder, to rape and enslave all human beings who do not believe as they do, that is the remaining 80% of humanity. If all the above items which any and all sane human beings are watching on television, reading in the newspapers, or listening to in the radio do not justify being afraid of Islam, what will? Muhammadan Islam is radical. It has no shame. Islam is radical, extremist, militant, intolerant, racist, and has no shades. Now let us analyze the term phobia. According to the dictionary, phobia is an exaggerated, usually inexplicable and illogical fear of a particular object, class of objects, or situation. According to Wikipedia, phobia from the Greek phobos means fear or morbid fear. It's when used in the context of clinical psychology, a type of anxiety disorder usually defined as a persistent fear of an object or situation in which the sufferer commits to great lengths in avoiding. Typically, it is proportional to the actual danger posed, often being recognized as irrational. In the event the phobia cannot be avoided entirely, the sufferer will endure the situation or object with marked distress and significant interference in the social or occupational activities, such as arachnophobia, fear of spiders, acrophobia, fear of open, high places. These, I repeat, are irrational fears. But fearing the existential threat of Islam to all infidels, unbelieving kuffar, is totally rational. While not fearing Islam, the threat to humanity would be irrational. Hence, ladies and gentlemen, it is not Islamophobia when they want us dead. Before I close this particular subject, I would like you to ponder the following axiom by a man called Karl Popper regarding tolerance that the politically correct dimwits do not comprehend. disappearance of tolerance. If we extend unlimited tolerance even to those who are intolerant, like the Muslims, if we are not prepared to defend a tolerant society against the onslaught of the intolerant, then the tolerant will be destroyed and tolerance with them. We should therefore claim, in the name of tolerance, the right not to tolerate the intolerant. Hence, ladies and gentlemen, we must never tolerate the intolerance of Islam and Sharia, nor allow them to soil our soil. Because those who tolerate evil are intolerant of good. In the last few hours, I have given you all the ammunition to utterly destroy anyone who tells you that Islam means peace, or Islam is a religion, which of course it is not, or Allah is God, which he is not, or Muhammad is a prophet, which he is not, or jihad is a spiritual struggle, which is not true, or Islamophobia is racism, which again is not true. We have achieved this based entirely upon the Islamic holy books and scripture, without deception, alteration, perversion, and or taking out of context anything. Now I would like to address the most important current event that the media in the USA and Europe are deliberately twisting for political and doctrinal reasons, thus avoiding telling the facts regarding the actual events in the Ukraine. Please double check me. Anyway, the Crimea to Russia, their backyard, is what Cuba is to the United States of America. Kennedy was willing to go to war, even nuclear, but would not allow the Soviets to have any missiles threatening the continental USA. The Ukraine is as important to Russia's security as Canada is to USA. Not all those who helped remove the elected Prime Minister of Ukraine were ordinary citizens who were upset with the status quo. Many Ukrainian neo-Nazis are involved, who represent a new destabilizing item in the Ukrainian crisis and should be of great concern to all those in the United States of America and Europe who want a free and democratic Ukraine. The ultra-nationalists. Ukraine and neo-Nazis were instrumental in ousting pro-Russian Ukrainian President Viktor Yanukovych. They were and are armed with helmets, masks, protective gear, weapons, and Molotov cocktails, and are trained to confront security forces by infiltrating the other demonstrators. The most prominent and violent of the ultra-nationalist groups is the Pravi Sektor, or Right Sector, whose leader has recently appealed once more to the Chechen Islamic chief terrorist Doko Umarov to launch terror attacks in Russia. It is obvious that John Kerry and the Europeans are helping to incite these groups, ignoring, as usual with Obama and his clueless administration who support the Muslim Brotherhood, the excesses of militant, Russophobic, and anti-Semitic forces inciting demonstrations in Kiev. Besides threat and empty gestures, what can and will Obama and the Europeans do to stop Russia from securing its interests, especially when Obama, the incompetent commander in retreat, is reducing assets to levels before World War II. The Nazi-style Ukrainian groups are identical in slogans, symbols and methodology as the Islamo-fascists. After all, Hitler's Mein Kampf is identical to Muhammad's Quran. Only 1400 years separate the two books. Otherwise, both are hate-mongering, war-mongering, racist, intolerant, duplicitous, dictatorial, vile, and hence totally undemocratic and ungodly. Anyone believing that Putin will let go of the Crimea and or Ukraine are thinking with their backside. The next few weeks will tell whether or not my conclusions are correct, or those of your leaders. Believe it or not, I advise Americans to go to www.rt.com, the Russian TV station, and be amazed at how much more balanced information they will get compared to the mostly insipid, uninformed ones from the major news media in the West. Another subject I would like to discuss is the case of the Middle East. Was there ever a Palestine and a Palestinian people? It's a very important question, because World War III could start in the Middle East because of these things. As usual, we shall address the subject with intelligence, with knowledge. Almost all people in the Muslim world, as well as those who support the cause of the Palestinians, do not actually know the facts behind the conflict or the origin of the names Palestine or Jew. In their erroneous perception, based almost entirely upon what they read or watch from a very biased media, the Palestinians are the underdog, the David, against the Israeli Goliath. Most of the people that we know of, such as the Sumerians, Assyrians, Greeks, Persians, Egyptians and Romans, all of them left a legacy of writing and their monuments, or are mentioned by their neighbors or contemporaries. The Palestinian people, obviously, if they truly existed, should also have left their mark or are mentioned by others. If our academics, historians, politicians, and others are so sure that Palestine and its people go back throughout most of recorded history, one would expect them to be able to answer a few very simple and basic questions about the alleged country of Palestine and its people, the Palestinians. For example, when was the country of Palestine founded and by whom? Where did the Palestinian people originate from? What were Palestine's borders? Who were its neighbors? What language did the Palestinians speak? What writing did they use? What manuscripts or records did they leave, whether written or engraved? What was their religion? Where are their temples? What monuments attest to their existence? What was the name of their capital? Can anyone name other major cities? What was their currency called? Are there any coins that attest to their economy? What was Palestine's form of government? Name its kings or rulers. What are their achievements? With which other people did the Palestinians interact? Where can one find any records wherein the name of the country of Palestine or its people are mentioned? What archaeological sites can one name? Where can one find the recorded history of these people? Whom did they conquer or were conquered by? Was Palestine ever recognized by a country whose existence at that time or even now leaves no doubt for misunderstanding? Can anyone name at least five Palestinian leaders before Arafat? Ladies and gentlemen, Since there is no such recognized country today, what caused its demise and when did it occur? Those who are lamenting the low thinking of a once proud nation, please tell us, when exactly was this proud nation brought down? By whom was it brought down? Also, what was it so proud of? Not even under the Ottoman Empire 500 years occupation was the name of Palestine used for any part or section of the Holy Land for administrative purposes. If there were an entity called Palestine and its people Palestinians, it would beggar logic and belief that the Muslim or the Ottomans would not have denoted the area with their name. After World War I, the British Mandate administered this very territory with the name Palestine, encompassing what is Jordan of today, as well as the territories of Israel, Gaza, and the West Bank. Palestine, after all, is only a name bequeathed to history by the victorious Romans over the Jews of Judea. Contrary to their original mandate, the British cut off from Palestine the territory east of the Jordan River and gave it to King Abdullah of the Hashemites. What was left was only 22% of the original. This was to be split in 1947 by the United Nations between Jews and Arabs, each getting about 11%. The Jews accepted. The Arabs refused. A two-state solution was available in 1947. The Arabs decided that they would not accept any partition. They wanted it all. So they declared a war of extermination in 1948 to destroy the Jews in Israel. Unfortunately for them, they lost. And there was the case of refugees. In all wars, there are refugees. Look what's happening in Syria today. Who is forcing them to run? Not necessarily anybody. They're running because they want to escape with their lives. 4 million people have become refugees in Syria. According to the UN figures in 1948, there were 750,000 Arabs. They were not called Palestinian. Nowhere in all of the resolutions of the United Nations was the name Palestine mentioned, always Arab refugees. 750,000. Ladies and gentlemen, between 1945 and 1950, over 40 million people became refugees all over the world. No one is mentioned for the last 65 years, except the Palestinians. Also ignored fully by United Nations and others, 950,000 Jewish refugees from Arab and Muslim lands. We never hear about them. All that the world hears about are the Palestinians. And what do the Palestinians do? Mass murder, terror, hijacked planes, all in the name of Palestine. That never existed. Jesus was crucified in a country called Judea. The title on the cross was initialed I-N-R-I. Jesus Nazarene Rex Iudim. Jesus, the Nazarite King of the Jews. And there were no Palestinians in sight. Not one. And yet, you have some Christian theologians speak about Jesus dying in Palestine. What a travesty. You know, as I'm speaking to you, Christians are being exterminated, literally eradicated in every Muslim country, especially in the so-called Palestinian territories. When the Israelis had control of Bethlehem and Nazareth very few of them are left. And yet, many Christians support the Palestinians. The very Palestinians who were so happy and jubilant on 9/11 when 3,000 Americans were holocausted. They were celebrating. They celebrated in the bombing of London, 7/7. They're celebrating. What have the Palestinians given to the world besides terror? Can anybody think of a single Palestinian who has contributed anything of value to humanity? In fact, can anybody name 10 Muslims from among 2,000 million who have contributed anything to humanity in the last 600 years? Back to you.
A good and lovely weekend, and God bless you. Thank you.